A very warm welcome to all.
Thank you.
And today's topic of our session happens to be the impact of words in our lifestyle and how it impacts our health and what can we do in order to make a shift or to transform from sickness or from sadness so that we move towards wellness and happiness. And this is just by the right picking and the right choice of words that we have in our life. I'll start the session with a very small story for all of you, and I hope that you find it interesting. It's about a monk who was traveling in a desert with his camel, and he was tired, so he thought he'll just take shelter somewhere there and stay there for some time, a day or two. And while he was staying there, he could find that in that small village there was some conflict going on in a family. And this unrest and the conflict in the family was because the head of the family passed away, and he was a very rich person. He owned many camels, and the problem or the conflict was the will, which he had written for his children. And he had three sons, and he owned 17 camels. And the will said that half of the camel is to be divided, is to be given to the eldest one, one third of the camel is to be given to the second son, and the third son will be owning one sixth of those camels. Now the dispute started. The dispute started because it's quite obvious. 17 camel, and they are to be divided in this order, half and one third and one sixth. Do you see any solution to this? And there is a solution. It appears. It appears. Yeah. It appears that probably this is like we are in a fix, and probably the sons would have ended up killing each other for the sake of the camels. But this didn't happen. Slowly this came to the traveler, the monk, and he heard it and he said, if you allow me, I am stranger to this village, but if you allow, can I offer some solution to this?
He had his camel
and he said, if I give you one camel of mine, that makes 18. So if we give the eldest one half of the camel, that makes it 9. If we make it one third, that comes to 1/3, that's 6.
One third of 18.
So that is 6 camels. And then the last is 1/6. So that makes 3 camels to the third one. So now if you add it up, how much does it come to? Sorry, 1/9. The last one is 1/9. So that comes to 2 camels for the last one. So 9 plus 6 is 15. 15 plus 2 is 17.
He gets his camel back.
And he gets his camel back. So what I'm meaning to convey through this small story is there was no exchange of camel happening anywhere. Nothing happened. If we look at a big mountain of problem, but then what solved the problem was just little shift of he didn't give him. He just said it, and the problem was made so easy. It happened. So this is like critical thinking, this is like problem solving, but it is all happening in the form of words. And that is the magic of words. So this is what I'm meaning to say, and I'm meaning to take in my session, that how the words can impact our entire lifestyle. We use so many words each day. We write, we read, we speak, all in the form of words. But if I ask you, what is word? Or what, why this was chosen, or why did you speak so? And you probably will be shrugging it off, saying what? Come on, it's just that. It's mere word. It's not that significant.
We give meaning to that.
Yes.
Words are words.
Yes. But we give. But many a times we just do not pay attention to what the meaning of that word is, to what the significance of that word is to us individually, and what it can mean to somebody to whom we are talking to whom we are sharing it. And we just take it very casually, which is not correct. And this has direct linkage. The word has direct linkage with all the feelings that we have, with all the emotions that we experience, with all the happiness that we feel, and with all the sadness that we feel. And we blame it on people. We find targets to say, because of them, because of him, or I have to do this and I have to do that, and this resulted into this blunder. But it is all in that small word which we choose. So what I'm meaning to say is that taking all these things, how the power of positive words help us in our life, and can we change our body with the choice of right word? How thoughts become words. We are very unaware of that. In fact, we use words so commonly and so unconsciously that the meaning doesn't come to our head, and we just use it in a very light way. How can our thought affect our health? And then what about the negative words? And what about their scary power that comes by default? And how the words shape our life? Is my word having an effect on anyone? Are they getting impacted? We don't pay attention to that. What about sound, words and our health? All of them are correlated. Then we'll be sharing the proactive tools, certain proactive tools which will help us understand how can we in fact fix the sound which surrounds us. Our body believes each word which we speak. Then the effect of negative words on our health, and what can we do to change that. There are certain fighting words, then there are arguments happening, lots of disputes happening, lots of differences happening, and we find no meeting of mind happens. That results in big fights, big arguments, big ego problems. So what are the ways in which we can eliminate these words from our dictionary and make ourselves at lesser risk, so that we don't have to deal with heart issues and we don't have to deal with risk like that of cancer? And we can change all that. And words are very powerful. So the power of words, which can be used by healthcare providers even. And this has amazing results. Amazing. How is this affecting our children? The way we talk to our children. How is it affecting our children? And how is it affecting their self-worth? And what kind of message are we communicating to our children while we are talking to them in the form of mere words? So this is all that we'll be taking in our session today. And we'll just try to find out what is the capacity of the word which we have. If we look into our past, into our scriptures and into our great leaders who have been born, we are being told and we are being taught, mind is everything. You become what you think. And this is being taught by Buddha. And that is what it is. So anything that comes into our mind becomes thought. And after a while, it gets transformed into words. And after it gets transformed into words, it takes no time to convert into action. So this is also interrelated, thought, word and action. There was a wonderful picture which depicted, I do not have that painting here, but I'll just make you see in a pictorial format. This is one individual who is sitting here, and there is another individual who is sitting like this. Now this individual also has a hammer and a nail in his hand, and the same is here. So there is another hammer and there is another nail in his hand, and they both are sitting facing to each other, bending towards each other. And while they are bending towards each other, it is like with that nail in one hand and a hammer in the other, they are constructing them. So this individual is constructing him, and this individual is constructing him. And the name of these individuals are thought and word. So this is Mr. Thought, this is Mr. Word. So this thought is shaping word, and this word is shaping thought. So it is undebatable which one comes first. Undebatable. Some might conclude, or some might raise their hand saying thought is the first one which comes. Some might stand up and say, no, it's the word which comes first and thought comes later. It is so interlinked, so interlinked. So this is what I'm meaning to say, that we cannot ignore the significance of any of them. And so we need to be very cautious about what we are wanting to convey, what kind of word we are choosing. Now, it is like all that we experience in our life is in the form of words. So the root of our experience lies in words, and it gets fructified in the form of our actions, in the form of our gestures, in the form of our behavior. It gets into all those things. But the root lies somewhere in the thoughts and the words. And it is very essential that the words that we are these days using, it can be in the form of speech, it can be in the form of writing, it can be in the form of our action, but it is not mere word. It is like we are creating our reality by our words. So our reality is shaped by the choice of our words. And based on the word which we are choosing, we are manifesting lot of things for ourselves, and we are throwing it out all in the universe, which starts creating our surrounding as well. So definitely, it is not mere word. It is a big thing, a big, big thing. And then the words have so much of an influence in us, so much of an influence, that it can inspire us, it can lead us, it can bring us into tears even. It can reduce us, it can erode us, it can explode us. So words are that powerful. The words can change our relationships, it can change our demeanor, it can change our business, it can change our financial status, it can change our success, it can change into failure. So that's what I'm saying, it is manifesting itself into the universe in a very powerful format. If I give you, or if I rather ask you all, how has the words changed your life? And if I take you into retrospection, you'll be amazed. A word like, marry me. A word like, it's a girl or it's a boy. For some, it's a girl can be like, oh wow, I'm blessed with a daughter. And for some, it can be like, oh my God, not again. The words created an impact, and even if you are hearing it now, you can feel that power of emotions the way you would have felt some 40 years back, 20 years back. Yes. You can feel the same intensity now. Or the word like, you're hired, your first job, and when somebody said you're hired. Or probably where you have given all your effort and you're very persistent and you're very passionate about your job, and someone says you're fired. And when someone says you're guilty and someone says no, you're not guilty. You see the kind of relief it gives? And it is mere word. It is mere word. But it is very powerful. So this is what I'm meaning to say, that words need not be ignored. Or for example, we are witnessing the cricket match, yes? And somebody exclaims, like, you would have fallen asleep and you couldn't witness that match. And the morning when you woke up, your son or your daughter or your grandchildren would rush up to you and say, like, we won. And at times, when somebody would have approached you with a very sulky and gloomy face and would have uttered, we lost. So you could feel the significance and the power of word. It sinks deep within into your heart, and you might be feeling like, oh my God, that's the strength of word. And we live in such technological advancement time. This is the best phase in terms of technology. And even that is rather not aloof from the words. If I give you, for example, or if I ask you, how many of you do not use Google even for once in a day? The answer probably will come as no. We all have become so much dependent and rather so much as a slave that instead of referring any book, we just we just keen in our phone or on our laptop, and we get that information. Now, what is Google actually doing? Google is doing nothing except for focusing heavily, emphatically, in organizing the words. So it organizes the words and it keeps it. So the moment you enter in your search bar, it gives you all the data there, dished out on a silver platter. Now at your service, sir, 200 pages, refer as many as you want. So this is the beauty of Google. And it is not letting anyone else take the lead. Now, it is not just in the form of few keywords. Google might come up and say, no, we do it for maps, we do it for images, we do it for photographs, we do it for some research topics, we do it for various templates. But when you take the gist of all and the substance of all, it all gets reduced into word. Now let us move into the another technological advancement, and that is the online transaction which happens through various sites, for example Amazon or OLX. Yeah, even there, it is all nothing but the magic of word which is happening there. You find there something like one click checkout. You find something there like pre-order. You find there something like along with these many items, you can also see these. Yeah. Yes, and one gets so much charmed by all these that they keep visiting, revisiting and revisiting the sites. So it is all about the words there, the sequencing of the words there, the kind of passion it generates in you. Then next you can move to Twitter, and Twitter has got its own handle, and through the handle it sets the trend. So if we have something like, I write something like cancer, I'll get everything in the search as well as in the Twitter, all the information relevant to that. Apart from all these things that we find in the technological world, we also come across, we are talking of the significance of words and we are talking of health. So let me give the example of a doctor and a patient and the interaction between a doctor and a patient. There's a patient who visits the doctor, and the doctor says, after diagnosing, I doubt, but it seems cancer. And it's mere word. It is mere word. But there is something so very shattering in terms of experience for that one particular patient, that he feels as though death is outside the door. The moment he's out of the cabin of the doctor, probably death is the only one thing which is waiting for that patient. How to do this? small world. And the patient comes outside, and the next thing what the patient wants to do is Google it out on the website and find out. So he does all kind of search, like what kind of cancer am I being told? Is it any organ cancer? And starts finding out cancer treatments. He goes first to his specific cancer type, then goes to cancer treatment, and keeps on searching, and he finds several pages, reads hundreds of pages, until he finds one page which generates in him something called as hope. And he is like, oh, this can save me. And finally I found it here. And what has happened, that in a day, different kind of emotions. One was death, terrible. And this is hope. So from tears to little kindling of some hope, I'll survive. I can make it. And who is doing all that? It's just this, and it's just this. So there is a complete shift of emotion happening. Here there is no possibility to survive, but here is like, come what may, yes, there are ways for me to survive, and I can make it, and I must do it. So this is what I'm trying to signify. Even in the words, or even in the field as that of religion, we cannot say words are not important. I'm just going to give you the name of God. You can probably say, I say Lord Krishna, I say Lord Jesus, or I say Allah. What do you experience with them? These are only three words, but they carry with them huge difference. Huge belief of people, huge difference in the customs and traditions and values, everything separated. Not just that, even in the political scenario, this can be found out. If I just say, for example, this. Three alphabets, B, J and P. But everything is different. And the moment I utter something like this, we don't utter anything to each one now. But there's something which you have understood, and there's smile on the face. And again, probably you'll be into laughter if I say this. So this is how the words are impacting our life. And this is what we need to understand, that words can change our life forever. Words can change our lifestyle forever. Words can change our health forever, towards betterment. Now it's more important for us to understand how our thoughts becoming words. You remember this? Two individuals sitting together, and they are like kneeling and creating each other. So when I say a word, this means this word is having at the backdrop some purpose. And that's the reason why I'm saying this. So that means there is some intention for this at the background, and then the word. There is an intention. So you can pick any word to any one particular person. You have a reason to say that word. And many a times you're not conscious what word you're picking. And so you say ki, I would have said just like that. But it's not so. We don't say that without any intention behind it. So there is a proper purpose to have that one particular word being uttered out. And we must be careful about that. So this one particular word which you have uttered to somebody is with intention. And this intention on being heard or on being understood can create a turmoil in the psyche of the person whom you have spoken it. And that person can be shaken on hearing that one particular word of yours. And each word is, whichever word is expressed, has a default attachment file. This is the attachment file. It comes by default. The word, by default, what is coming attached with it is the emotion. So if you say to a lady something like, beautiful, why would she smile? Because the word has got an emotion which is attached to it. If you say to, why would that person get angry? Because there is an attachment file coming with default that makes that person feel very sad and at times arrogant even. Like, how dare you call me this? So do you think I'm like that? Nobody likes that. So this is what? So there is this intention always with the word and which can create a turmoil. And so the words need to be appropriate. When we say emotion, there is an energy in motion. So the moment you have uttered that word, this energy is set into motion and reaches the listener. So from the listener, then you get a response, and if that is not to your liking, you find that energy is transferred to you and you are again set in motion. Yes? So this is how the words make their impact, and it's, if I am to tell you how to understand what kind of vibration are each word is making, see, what I am talking is completely scientific. There was, in fact, a Japanese scientist, Mr. Emoto, yes, he did this research, and he found out that the water, when it's frozen, it gets shape of crystal. The impure water or the polluted water does not have any crystal formation on being frozen, but the pure water has proper crystal formation. And what was found was that he kept two jars, the mason jars with the water in it, and in one jar he had written something, some gratitude. Or simple, you can say, I love you and I hate you. Or you are a fool and I love you. Or simple, thank you and I hate you. And he took it and kept it there. And what happened was, here, where there is this gratitude, here, the water got beautiful crystal structure. Whereas here, there was no crystal formation, no vibration. In the same way, he did it in two mason jars, rice, cooked rice, and that was being kept in two jars. He kept it for 30 days, asked the children to go and speak the words, thank you, to one of the mason jar, and to the other one, you are of no use. And what happened was, it remained fluffy and white, where the words of gratitude were spoken, and this became greyish in color where it was, you're of no use. See, that is the amazing impact of words. Amazing. And we feel, I just said it some 15 days back. Is it harming you? I forgot I would have said I hate you, or you're not good, or you're useless. And how does it matter? 15 days back, I forgot, you should have forgotten. No, it's not. It's not forgotten, but it depletes the amount of energy, it drains the positive energy from the individual whom it was being spoken to. And that creates a lot of turmoil, a lot of grief and a lot of sadness. And that is what we are trying to pitch in. So what we need to understand is that we get so many things coming in our way by many people whom we meet. Some might be praising us, some might be encouraging us, some might definitely be ridiculing us and blaming us and criticizing us. What is in our control? There's nothing in our control. Nothing is in our control. We are being caught in traffic. We cannot go and control the lights according to our wish. We cannot go and control the long queue to be reduced and be given an easy passage to go and join there. We also cannot control the rain, sudden downpour of rain. We cannot control the power cut which happens. All that remains in our control is our response to that individual. Yes. So if there is anyone who is ridiculing, or somebody who is criticizing, or somebody who is blaming, or somebody who is putting us down every time, day after day, what is in our control is to not to respond in the same way as it is being wished. So stay away from that. And the moment you stay away from that, you do not send out any negative energy. And let's remember that the container which holds the poison is the first one to get damaged. So if somebody has given us the anger and we take it in us and we believe that in that arrogance we have spoken or we spit out few words, arrogant words, fuming, burning words, verbal argument, and we think that I've passed it on and I've given it back. You haven't given it back. You have stored it with yourself for longer time, longer duration, for you to find trouble within yourself. And you are creating toxin in your own body, and which is going to deteriorate the health. And because of all that stress which has happened, your body starts generating stress hormones. And that depletes all positive energy from your body. And you are like, what do I do now? I didn't do anything wrong. Now why am I suffering now? It is because worry, it is because hurt, it is because guilt is eating up all the energy which is so very positive in you. And that makes you fall short of positivity. In our entire day, if we are having some 60,000 thoughts occurring in our mind, 50,000 of it is negative. We need to train our mind in a proper way. So that proper training has to happen. And we don't do that. We do not train our mind. We believe I am what I am and I am right. And not just once, I am always right. So we are more than contented with our brain and we are like, I don't need any training. And what my brain? It's the perfect brain in the world. And I am the perfect owner of that wonderful brain. So I don't need any training for myself. And that's where we need to change our thought process. It can be anything. It can be as negative as I'm ugly. It can be anything as I'm fat, It can be anything as I'm not beautiful. It can be anything as nobody likes me. Or they are always after me. Or they just will not miss a single chance to make me a failure. Or it can be as simple for the students like, I'm not good in maths, or I can never do maths. So these are the tiny kinds of negative thoughts which keeps on occurring, keeps on working. And you see, this is not done consciously. This is not done consciously. It comes in your mind on your own. What if I go and talk to them and they don't like it? What if I make it very interesting, but I feel that it's not of their interest? Now this is not conscious choice of mine, but lot of fear and lot of uncertainty within me, which is creating all these kind of things and which is making me more prone towards my own negative thoughts. And these are all self-deprecating, self-defeating statements. And we are like, I don't abuse anyone. But what about, how am I in my relationship with my own self? I'm always undermining myself by saying I'm not good. I'm not worthy of all this good treatment. People don't like me in my family. I'm not up to the mark. If I even put all the good effort, I won't be paid with good dividends. I won't be getting rewarded. So these are all self-deprecating ones. And I'm demeaning my own self-esteem, my own self-worth. And this can result into severe health problem within our body. Now this is also not in your control. Some people have this habit of repeating these kind of statements. They keep on saying it continuously. They don't want to. But if they find 5 minutes of spare time, they go into this thought process. And this is like enough of homework for another 15 days. And this is sufficient for our health to be deteriorated. So a lot of care is to be taken so that we do not come into this. And we need to understand that when we talk of training our mind, when we talk of training our mind, we need to do it by certain techniques of meditation, of mindfulness, of visualization, and of affirmation. And this is very essential. So if we are in the habit of meditating, even if it is 10 minutes in a day, and 10 minutes is not so much of time consumption for yourself, you're working for your family, you're working for your children, you're working for your office, you're working for many other people. When you contribute so much of your time to others, how much is 10 minutes for yourself out of 24 hours? Very little. But that little span of time will make a big difference in your state of mind, which will be very peaceful. So it is very essential that you stick to this. You can even stick to mindfulness, and mindfulness is nothing but being in the present, just to be what you are, how you are, without casting a glance into something called as past, into something called as this past has passed, and so it is called as past. It nowhere exists. Its existence is only again in your thought. It doesn't exist in reality. So we do not have to think of this past. This is so uncertain. We do not know about it, how it is going to be tomorrow, how it is going to be 10 years later, how it is going to be 20 years later. So the moment you come out of it, it can be anything like what if in future, in my old age, I get caught with this disease? It nowhere exists in the present. There is no possibility, but then it's just a thought which you have taken in future and you have started thinking on it. Or it can be anything, like what if death comes to me before time, then what about my children? Who's going to look after them? How will they carry with life? And it's scary. It's scary. So what we need to do is strike it off. Nobody knows this. Death is inevitable. So why think of 20 years later? It can be like if I'm out of this building and a truck comes and smashes. So here I was thinking for 20 years later, but then probably next 10 minutes are not there for me. So what was I wasting my time for there? Then this past, it has already finished. Its existence is only here in the head. So why keep it in the head and make it more stressful, painful, full of grief and sadness? Strike it off. Be with the present. Enjoy with the family. Be with the kids. Love them. Give them all your all that you can, with all that you are, in all your best capacity. And you'll be happy, and even they will be happy.
But ma'am, one question. For our planning, see, for planning our life for any company, past and present, you cannot link it. We may not dwell on that. But that is required, because
it
otherwise
is.
You cannot.
Yeah, it is.
It present.
Is. It is. It is essential. But not to add stress to life.
Yeah.
So in that case, one has to be like opportunity seeker. One has to be problem solver instead of problem creator. So there, if our thought process goes where we can find some solution, where we can make it more better than what it is today, then probably it's okay. So we are planning for a better future. But we are not planning to keep ourselves stressed every day for another 20 years. So this is where we need to put a hold. Visualization is very important. You can visualize what all things you want in your life. And as I've said earlier, the words which we throw into the universe is creating the reality. So when you visualize certain things, you're actually manifesting it in your own surrounding. And the last is affirmation. Now these affirmations can be as simple as, I'm fabulous. One might say, I want lot of money for me in these many years. Instead of saying that in lengthy sentence, make it in very short sentence. I am fabulous. That includes everything. Right from your health to your mental state of mind to your financial status, everything. So I am fabulous. And keep repeating it, affirming and reaffirming it. Because the more you repeat, the more it gets validation. This is again scientific. The more it gets mental validation. And that is the reason why you would see the commercial market or the social media, in fact, booming lots of advertisements at regular intervals of time. And that is so much of repetition happening that the moment you find one company's product being flashed on a TV screen, like for a month after every 5 minutes break or 10 minutes break, you start validating that company's product and you say you endorse it. You go to the mall and you say, I want that product. Why? Because it has been validated here.
And nowadays they are giving these subliminal messages also.
Exactly.
Media is very powerful.
Very powerful. And media makes use of words. You see, it's tagline, it's headline, it's so eye-catchy, it's so much pricking to the ears, you're like, oh, what has happened? And then when you sit and listen, you're like, oh, I wasted my half an hour for what? Like I'm healthy and I'm well, I'm prosperous, I'm having abundance. you can say something like, I'm strong and I'm flexible, very peaceful and very positive. So this is, now let us for a while, and it's this, how the factors. If I just ask you to just close your eyes for a while, and I'm going to say certain words. So let me, while I'm just repeating those words, just keep pay attention to the words and the kind of experience you feel. That's it. So just close your eyes for a while. And the words are fire, bomb, fight, conflict, blood, battle, sword, explosion, idiot, duffer, pathetic, shameful. You can open your eyes. So what the experience was like? The experience was very violent. Did you feel good about hearing those words? No. And these were only words. There was no sword here, no battle happening here, no bloodshed happening, no war. Yes.
Heavy attachments.
Yes, heavy. So it is these words, and what are these words doing? If you remember, I had earlier said, each word has with itself an emotion attached. And you feel it automatically.
And also an image attached to it.
An image attached to it.
It was not there, we were searching for.
Yes.
When you say searching explosion. For
the problem. Yes, yes, exactly. Where did it happen? In the last occurrence.
Mumbai bomb blast.
Yes. And it is also lined up, you know. Yes. At times it is sequential, and at times it is, we have to do the random search, but then it comes.
Now just search for the back.
It's children, smile, mother, family, beautiful fragrance, wonderful garden, butterflies, angels, God, peace, love, family. And please open your eyes. So how is it now?
Good feeling.
Good feeling.
Good image.
Thank God for that.
Sorry?
Picnic and all
that. Yes, exactly. So this is how it is. It is all in the form of mere words. But even the words have that immense capacity to create the change in your emotions. And the moment that words are being heard, it makes a huge difference like this. It's like 360 degree difference. And you would want to hear and rehear those good things. And you would never want to hear words which, you know, drains away all the energy from you, which makes you feel full of stress. So this is how we need to understand. There are times when certain things do not exist. We are not like that, but somebody keeps on saying that to us. What happens is that it starts creating the illusion of truth. And this is what we must keep ourselves away from. And this is where we must not allow others also to approach and do that. If somebody keeps on saying this, you're a liar, you're a liar, you're a liar. What are they doing? They are creating in an individual the illusion wherein that individual will come to a belief, I am a liar. It is not actually. somebody did that, and how damaging is this? How pathetic is this? And this is not always happening from external sources. This is we ourselves also. I'm not worth it. I am not capable. I cannot do this. This will create an illusion. People in my family don't love me. Again, that will create an illusion. Then you'll start looking at all of them with the same perspective. Oh, they did this way. Probably they don't love me. Or today I came back from office and nobody offered me a glass of water. Probably they don't love me. And yes, it is now authenticated. What I was thinking is exactly correct.
They don't care.
They don't care. They don't value so much. They used to do that earlier, but not now. So we do not have to do that. And if you want to again feel the impact of negative words, please go and sit there for as minimum as 5 minutes with somebody who is a chronic complainer. You will definitely not like sitting there. And you will wish, I if given me a chance, I can be the marathon winner today. Because I want to run away from here as fast as I can and go away from the chronic complainer. And that's the reason why it is being said that choose your friends and choose your words wisely. Choose them wisely. That will help you in your life. I have already spoken of that. So we need to understand that our words, that the words that we are speaking for ourselves, which are self-defeating, are in fact creating false self-image for us. We are not like that, but we are making ourselves believe this, and which is very harmful. Now, how the words we... So this, I hope you would have got that. Shape our life and how it will affect others. In the same way, the sound, words and our health, they are all correlated. Supposingly you're there in your home and you're enjoying your presence in the family, and there is like children, they're watching their television serial and they would have raised the volume and it's too high. Or probably it can be some senior person in your home and would be finding it difficult to hear that and would have raised the volume, and you're like, oh no.
The volume will go more
than
that.
More than that. So then, what is to be done? We just have to understand that it is to be communicated to that particular person, even if it is this height or this height or of this stature in our family. We can communicate, please. If you can, just lower it. So that it can be audible to all and it can be peaceful for all the ears. That can be requested. Now, there was again a scientific experiment which was being done, and it was found that with the musical instrument being played and the sand was there, the patterns on the sand were different with the difference in the vibration. So if that can happen on an object, what about we as individuals? We are nothing but collection of molecules. So when there is a sound which is coming in a very polite and humble way, is it not changing our body's molecule? It is. On the contrary, if there is some high pitch, is that not distorting and disturbing the molecule in our body? It is. Nerves, yes. And you start feeling, you know, every nerve can be felt. You can feel them here, you can feel them in your palm, you can feel it in your leg. Something happens in your heart and you can sense that. Yes. Numbing everything. Like, you're like, now what do I do? Helpless. So this is how it is all affecting our life and affecting the life of others. Now next is, how does this negative words, they affect our health? We did hear it, like sticks and stones can break my bones, but words cannot. Yes. Now, this was a saying of some past, where it was like, I cannot be hurt by words, but in these days it cannot be so.
I think Aristotle...
Yes. Long back. So what I'm meaning to say is that words are very, very powerful, energy driven. They induce a lot of energy to the listener, and they are full of energy to the speaker as well. So we need to understand that the for example, anyone who would have spoken very negative to you face to face, it would have hurt you very badly. It doesn't mean that one has to be face to face in conversation with somebody to feel bad on hearing the negative word. It happens if we hear it from some third person as well. Now that person is nowhere in front of us, but then even that vibration comes to us and distorts us completely. So it is creating a lot of impact in our body. And our body believes every word that we say. The body cannot distinguish between what is now and what is imaginary. It cannot distinguish. So even if you're imagining for yourself, which is untrue, then that is believed by the body. And this is a very powerful thing. The moment we understand this, we will immediately stop this wrong imagination part in the form of our thoughts. So when the thoughts are stopped, your word formation automatically stops, and your depletion of good energy also stops then and there itself. So we have to be very careful. We have something like the fighting words, which I would have mentioned here. Yes. What are these fighting words? The words which leads to pull down the confidence of somebody, or to demotivate somebody, or to like throw in all negativity or as an obstacle. You cannot do this, you don't have the capacity. Did you even think of doing it? Don't think so. And again, repetition will create the mental validation. You will start believing it, and it will result in very worse damaged self-image in your mind, and you will give up for life. You will give up for life. So the moment the doctor says cancer, what we are supposed to do is not to get dominated by a small word. It is only five-lettered word. Not to allow that word dominate us, but to understand that I am more powerful than this small five-lettered word. And however fatal it can be, I am given all the resources within which can take me out from here and bring me, if not to that exact wellness state, then at least to the state of my good survival. And believe me, your thought has immense power to take you away from that state of unhealthy or hopeless state to something where you can feel proud and say, I did it, I'm on top of the world. Yes.
On top of it.
Yeah, on top of that, yes. That I have subjugated you, and now
I'm the master.
This is very important for us to understand, because if we are there in an argument, what we are doing is we are fueling, we are providing all the fuel which is essential to ignite that particular argument, and it can go worse to infinity. It can go worse. So what we are needed to do is that not to let that happen. All that we can find in these days is that lot of marriages being distorted, lot of issues being cropped up because of this something called as fighting words, or we can name it as argument. And it is seen that it is due to huge shape of one's ego. This distortion in the familial life, in a wonderful, lovely family, it gets shaken and it gets broken. And without awareness of it. And that makes it more pathetic, without awareness. The person doing this is unaware that this is leading me to blowing up my own home, to blowing up my own relationships for life, to blowing up the love of my family. So this is where it is very, very alarming. So we need to understand that disagreements can happen, differences can occur, but not to the extent wherein it can lead to fire in one's own home. And how pathetic it is where we are burning our own home with our own mouth. It is very pathetic. It is a very sorry state, and it is a very pitiful state that this happens. And complete negligence is given to the entire family, to the parents, to the children, to the spouse, to various members related in the family. So we must keep away from that. It can happen, arguments can happen in an office as well. It is being said people leave companies not because of that particular organization. They leave it for
because of people.
So don't get into these, or don't bathe oneself into the ocean of negativity. Fill yourself with all the positive thoughts and all the positive words, so that it becomes easy for you to survive in that difficult place and you can come up to it. Changing others is difficult, but yes, one can change oneself. So instead of expecting people to change, change one's own response. Just change one's own response. So the moment we change our response, we'll find the glass is different. We'll find everybody has changed. You know, there was once a person, a gentleman, who said after his retirement, he said, I want to go and have a look at the city. And let me, and this time I'm not going with anyone. So nobody to accompany me. No wife, no children, no grandchildren. I will go on my own. So he went on his own and took the entire day. By night he came back and he had the sad and gloomy face, and the entire family was disturbed. Oh my God, we didn't accompany, so he definitely was devoid of stress. So what makes him more sad and gloomy today? What has happened? And they asked hesitantly. And he said, I don't know why, but you know, it's very difficult to find everybody in wellness state of physical state. So it was like, why, what happened? And he said, I don't know, but I didn't like, you know, wherever I looked, I found people suffering from jaundice. And nobody said anything, and they just moved away from there. And what happened? The wife, when she opened the bag of her husband, she found yellow glass. So this is how it is. So our perspective depends on us. We just need to change our perspective. And if we change our perspective, automatically it'll change our words. And if our words are changed, automatically the response from the other end is going to change, and automatically you're going to feel like, oh my God, he has changed. Nobody has changed. Our response is changed, and so we get the different response coming from the other end. So now when we talk of health, there are a lot of stress hormones which are being produced in the body due to stress, cytokines and for diabetes, 2-type, and for obesity and everything. Now all these can be reduced if we start using the power of positive words. It is very important for the words to be used by the healthcare providers. Reason being, the patient is in need of, is in dire need of encouraging words, encouraging support, or convincing guidance being given, or to console somebody, very aptly said. But what we find in these commercialized days is that, or this era, is that people don't have time to do all that. So if there is a health care provider who comes and just gives a little pat on the back and says, you're doing good, or your results are showing little improvement, you know, it pumps up double the amount of blood into the heart of the patient, and the patient starts feeling, oh my God, my body is recovering and I have the power to do it. If I could survive this, damn it, I can run tomorrow. So this is the feeling they get. And there are, in fact, in a research which is being done, it is being found, there are almost more than 700 words which the healthcare providers must be using in their normal conversation with the patient. You're doing good, you're fine, your body is healthy, you're recovering, you have the power.
Encouragement.
Sit there, if the healthcare provider sits there, and even if does nothing, but just touches the hand of the patient.
Yes, that also.
That is such a reassurance to the patient. Oh my God, somebody gave so much of time. Medications do their work. I don't undermine to say that medicines are not important. They will work only when it is supported by the care and the concern of these healthcare providers. So it can be the nurse, it can be the doctors, it can be the surgeons, it can be anyone. It can be anyone. I remember an instance where the surgeon operated, and it brings a big, big stress. I mean, the words like cancer or the word like heart problem brings grief or sadness, not just to that patient, but to all the family members. And one can see it in the eyes, and it is very painful. The misty eyes are very painful. But yes, it gives a great amount of relief when the surgeon, after the operation, comes and says, perfect.
Yes.
You're brave enough. So immediately the patient is like, I have developed huge immunity that I can be discharged tomorrow morning. And the family is so relaxed and so relieved and so stress-free that they feel like, one, oh my God, we are taking our happy family member back home.
Yeah.
So this is very important for us to understand. And now let's come to this, how is it affecting our children? How the words that we speak.
Huge.
Huge. And it is unmeasurable. And the kind of lifestyle that we are living in today's time is such where both the parents are working and the children are continuously at dispersal to the media and the maid servants. And there is no proper choice of words which is being thrown towards them.
Yes.
And they hear it by default and they start speaking that. And the severity of it is realized only at later stage when automatically some word which is not of your like or not of your choice, you hear it and you're like, oh my God, from this height if I'm hearing this and I don't use this and I don't speak this, so from where did this come? And then it becomes alarming and very important. And as small as 2-year-old child looks up to the parent, would not understand each word which is being spoken, but the child makes it up, whether this is good or this is for bad. So if there is a child who is just learning to walk and has fallen down, if you notice it very carefully, the children, after falling down, immediately do not cry.
Yes.
They look for the audience first. They look for the audience.
Nobody is there immediately.
They will, yes.
No one reacts. No one.
So they look for the response coming from the audience. So if they find, oh, this audience has made a panicky kind of a face, that means it is severe. I need to act now. So they start shedding their tears. But if there is a parent who is like, oh, come on, it's okay, it's fine. You'll fall many number of times, but you're brave enough and strong enough, and you can learn how to walk. Chalo, chalo, it's okay. The child will get up and give a smile and start running. If it has, learned to walk and all. So this is what we are meaning to say. We must understand that our eyes have this inbuilt feature. Whatever it sees, it absorbs. Whatever it sees, it just absorbs and stores it for future utility. It might not use it immediately then and there, but it will absorb and keep it for another next time reference. Pick it up from there and dish it out there.
It's a deposit in bank.
Yes, it's a deposit. And withdrawal happens at some moment in future. So if we as parents are not watchful, are not careful about the choice of words that we're using with our children, then we are creating a bad future for our children there. So if we are abusing, if we are fighting, if we are demeaning the presence of somebody, if we are disrespecting the family members, the eyes are watching and children are best observers. They observe. Children do not learn by instructions. They learn by examples. So we have to understand, we must as a parent be the best role model for them, at least in our values, at least in our behavior, so that the children have some good example to follow. And then they do it. And this is very essential in terms of words. Right choice of word, right meaning of word. I'll give you the small examples of how heavy these words are and how light some words are. You can experience it on your own and feel the difference. For example, we have it in our language of communication, something like a woman at home or a wife at home would be cribbing. I have to cook food for all of them. And I have to wake up early in the morning to get all things right in proper time. Or it can be from the gentleman, I have to go for my office daily. And I have to work for all these people sitting at home and watching television. And I have to do things which I just don't like. So the moment these words are being spoken, what kind of experience do you feel? What kind of emotion do you feel?
It appears that they are all unhappy.
They are all
unhappy. You are giving messages to yourself. You are helpless.
Yeah, exactly. Very unhappy, very helpless, and is it not a forced kind of a thing?
Yes. Forced.
It is forced. And too much of pressure can be said. I have to cook food for them. But then the moment I have this word, I have immense stress in my body and I just don't like doing that. And when I don't like doing that, definitely it will be showing it in my outcome. All I choose to go to office. I choose to earn money for my family's happiness. I choose to cook food for them. That will keep my family healthy. So I'm just disallocating this word or removing it completely from my dictionary. Or if I give you another example and I say, in an office, there is a boss and he says to his subordinate, see, listen, Mr. ABC, this work which you did is superb. But I think you should have made this presentation in some XYZ ways, and it would have given more better results. Had it been you as that subordinate, after leaving the boss's cabin, what feeling do you feel? What emotion do you feel gushing?
Waste ho gaya,
sir. Sab kuch waste ho gaya.
He never appreciates.
He never appreciates. I knew it.
Some fault.
One or the other fault, he'll find it out and he'll make all my efforts futile. So you come out, you're unhappy. And what, if I ask you, what made you feel that? What, where? He did not criticize you. He did not use any abusive words.
But he used but.
Yes, he used the word but. And it's repeated word. And it's making so much of difference. Can I replace this? Yes, of course. Yes, very correct. He can say and. This was excellent presentation, and I would appreciate if you include these ABC in your next presentation.
Yes.
And you're like, I nailed it this time. He never appreciates, but this time he had to. He did not do anything. He kept his sentence same. All he did was he just changed the conjunction. And the entire feeling is changed. And that's the reason why I'm saying words are very, very powerful. So the moment we change our word, all things changes. So if there is something like, I must do this, I must be disciplined in school, I must reach my office in time. So what it conveys, again it is a force format. So I can, instead of saying I must, I can say I prefer. I prefer reaching my office before time. I prefer doing this. So when you change your certain words, the entire feeling and the entire emotions have changed. If only they would have not said this, if only I would have had this, that is. So instead of saying, this if only is like little grudge inside.
I wish.
I can replace it by I wish. I wish I could do it in this way. I wish I had this.
I wish it was this.
It was this way.
Yeah, you are wishing, so.
Yes, I'm wishing. So again, it can be I choose to. No, they made me made for each other. No. No. So it misunderstanding of the cage. Yes, exactly. If I had again grudge, and again it can be, I wish. I will try. Now please note this try is an amazing word. The moment we say the word try, what happens? Supposingly your friend is requesting or is like inviting, or please come on this Saturday and we'll have a good time and we'll sit and talk about our childhood days. And if you're not wanting to go, what is your response?
Try.
I will try. That means, yes, no, indirectly saying no. And yes, mental picture. There is no best. So the picture mentally is prepared, and that is like, how much you invite me, I know I'm not coming for sure. And I'm certain. And you don't end up going there. So this is how the try is. Whenever we use the word try, we are sure 100%.
And there is no try. Either you do it or you don't.
So Nike also says, just do it.
Yes.
Just do it. Then the last is, that's just the way I am. There are people who say that. I am like this. You like in this, you can say, there's something I can do. Let's find the way to do it. I can't.
So instead of saying this, this, I will not let anybody else's mood, words in your vocabulary when you're speaking, that much good it will be. Stop using the word not. Because the brain does not understand, it does not process the word not. For example, if I ask you to close your eyes, just close your eyes.
I don't open.
please, close your eyes and think of anything that you can in the world. Please do not think of a pink colored giraffe dancing.
Let's cross.
There were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 giraffes.
Please open your eyes. Now what has happened?
That pink giraffe.
There were 10
pink giraffe has come. Yes, and we don't have any pink giraffe in reality. But what the brain has done, it has created that pink colored giraffe and it has made the giraffe dance also.
Yes.
So anytime you speak the word not, it will be not processed and it will do it. So when we were small and we were being told by our parents, do not read comics now, what we waited was for them not to see us and just go and open the cover page and see that. So this is how it is. The more you use not, the more
You are attracting a regular person. Do not speak to other people.
That's the reason why they speak. So instead of saying, do not spit, keep it clean. Or keep control of yourself from throwing.
But municipality has got way, do not speak. They put that banner.
Better to keep it clean. Do not speak.
Yes, keep the environment clean. Keep your surroundings
clean. Say clean zone.
Clean zone. If we tell a child, if he is playing the football at the home, in the drawing room, or the basketball, dribbling it in the room itself, you say, don't play here.
Yeah.
What the child does?
Harder.
Again and again. And you're like, what, don't you understand? And the child is looking at us. He doesn't understand. Don't you understand? Doesn't understand. And we are like, there's some problem with the child. But the problem is not with the child. Problem is in the word which we are using. So instead of this, you should have used play outside. Make the expectations clearer for the children. So when we are talking to them, let's tell them. Or don't abuse. Don't be disrespectful. Now the child is clueless. If not to be disrespectful, then what? Doesn't know. Or don't abuse. Then what? He said something bad. What should I do then? I don't know. Next time he'll slap and come. He said, he'll say, you said don't abuse. I didn't abuse, but I slapped. So this is how it is. We have to give the right kind of instructions, right kind of commands. And we must be very careful with this because that can lead to our good health and good lifestyle. We must take care of ourselves, not to demean ourselves, not to demean anybody else.